Teacher's Coffee with George Kokolas and Virginia Dooley.
I'm not going to start with the number of the episode this time.
Okay, then I will. Episode 23.
Okay, yeah, because we are very proud counting the one episode after the others, because we're advancing into this wonderful season. And actually, we're traveling to a wonderful country today.
Yeah, and that's Serbia. Beautiful Serbia.
Very beautiful Serbia, absolutely. And we also have a beautiful personality, a very active and passionate trainer for Serbia. Zdravka, if I'm pronouncing this correctly.
Excellent.
Majkić.
Majkić. In Serbian, we have ch.
Okay. That's too advanced for me. So Zdravka Majkić is with us today. Zdravka, welcome to Teacher's Coffee. So good to have you here.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting me.
As I said, you are a very passionate professional. And actually, I was impressed because we had the chance to meet for the first time at ISO Spain quite a while ago, a few weeks ago. So, and from what I've been following you for many months now, and I can see that you have delivered many presentations. You come very much in direct contact with the teachers. You're very much in the front line of training and talking to teachers. So I think you have a very clear insight of what is happening regarding ELT in your country. So my first question will be a very general one, maybe a cliche one, but I think that's the right question to start with. How can someone learn English in Serbia? What is the situation regarding English language teaching? What is being offered right now regarding English language classes?
Well, first, thank you for your invitation. And this announcement was great. You know, I feel like I'm VIP. Very famous.
Maybe you are.
Maybe. You know, teachers are not so popular, neither in Serbia, like not in other countries. But I can say that a lot of my colleagues in Serbia knows me and know about my work, because I'm really passionate, as you said before. And I have a contact with a lot of colleagues, not only in Serbia, but in other European countries. And teaching and learning English in Serbia is not different from other countries, you know. English is obligatory subject in state schools, like in any other country, mm-hmm. but it's not elective like German, like French, like Russian. You have to learn English. And at state schools, it's free. You don't have to pay. But mm-hmm. It's pretty difficult because we have only two classes per week. And we don't find that enough for regular learning or teaching. But there is wide range of opportunities to study outside of state schools, public schools, you know. Do you want face-to-face classes, hybrid online courses? You know, there is a wide range of online courses, and it depends on the learner. What are your interests? So you can study English for special purposes. You can study language coaching, whatever you need. There are opportunities for everyone, but you just need to be into, you know, you need to be interested in studying languages and to find your purpose. Why do you need English? And I think that we all do need English, because that's a language of global communication. You know, I always say to my students, wherever you go, you will find someone who knows at least a few words in English. And that's enough for the beginning.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's true. Everyone, or you can get around with a few words of English at anywhere, any place you might be on the planet. So since it's an obligatory subject, as you said, in the state schools, but then obviously there's also evening schools where you can practice or learn the language with maybe more interesting ways. What are the main learning objectives of the ELT teachers in your country? Is it so communicative so that students can speak, or is it, I don't know, to have a certain degree or certification? What's the main objective of teachers, would you say?
Well, unfortunately, the main objective and the main point in all classes is grammar, because our curriculum expect of us to teach grammar and grammar and grammar, you know, and we have students with passive knowledge, and when they graduate, they look after for some trainings and courses to practice their speaking skills, listening skills, writing skills, and degrees are very important in Serbia. You know, I would say it's a race for Cambridge's all degrees. And sometimes I think that students are not prepared, emotionally prepared for some degrees, for like B2, you know. I think they're not emotionally ready to write an essay or a letter of inquiry if they're 13 or 14. And they're expected to pass those exams. So I would put more... in first row, I would put speaking classes, you know, and I teach at a public school, elementary school. In Serbia, elementary schools are from 7 to 15 years old students. And I always say to my students, speak. It doesn't matter. Do you make mistakes or you don't? You know, just speak. Use your legs, use your hands, use your body, whatever. But just speak, because they're afraid to speak, you know. They think too much about grammar. And in that way, they're just afraid to make a mistake. And I find that totally wrong. They need to speak and to use language. What's the purpose of knowing language if you don't use it? And then we try to motivate them, you know. They use Instagram, it's very popular in Serbia, TikTok, Snapchat, games. And I always say to my students, how you can play games if you don't know English? And for example, footballer players, you know, all boys in Serbia wants to become football players. And then I always say to them, how are you going to sign contract? You know, they're going to give you something and you don't know what are you signing. So you must know English. Otherwise, you won't succeed as a footballer. I try to make comparison and to motivate them to find purpose of learning English.
Absolutely, Zdravka. And, you know, It's a paradox here, because we are having these podcasts and presentations and academic lectures on how we can improve communication. But we've been having this conversation with many trainers for over 20 years now. And apparently there are still many places in the world that teaching is focused more on grammar, on passive knowledge, as you said, rather than communication. So no matter what's going to happen, I think there are going to be certain people, podcasts or other institutions or sources that need to promote more this communicative approach, as you mentioned it, because it has to change. It has to change. And talking about students, and that was a really nice example that you said about the contract. But going back to the Serbian students, and I'm going to use another word of yours that I liked a lot, searching for your own meaning in learning. What do you think is this meaning for Serbian students today? Do they realize that this is a lingua franca that they need to speak in order to be able to collaborate, to communicate with people outside their country, or even within the borders of their own country? Or is it just another academic curriculum, or maybe a pastime activity simply to create a video on TikTok? How do the students perceive this? Have they realized how important maybe it is to communicate in English as a foreign language?
I think it depends on the teacher, on educator, you know. If you present them English classes in an interesting way, and if you show them the purpose of studying, what's then they like it. But if it's one more activity, one more class in a row, and they have six or seven classes every day, if that's additional homework they don't like to do, then they don't see the purpose, unless their parents insist on studying English, and we all parents insist on education. But if you make your classes interesting, and if they feel comfortable, and if they see that it's okay to make a mistake, you know, we all make mistakes in native language also, and it happens to me that I pronounce something incorrectly, or to make a grammar mistake, and then I said, oh my God, did you hear me? I made a mistake. Sometimes I do that in purpose, but sometimes I really make a mistake. I didn't want it, but it happened. Mm-hmm. So you need to be different. You need to be motivating. And actually, I think that teachers need to be motivated firstly, because if you find your class is boring and you're a teacher, imagine your students who are forced to sit there. They need to enjoy your classes, you know, and you need to help them to find the purpose of studying English. I like using short videos in TikTok because their concentration takes 10 minutes, 15 minutes for activities, and they need more short activities. I'm talking about teenagers because I work with teenagers, and they always tell teachers, use TikTok, use the Instagram, use Snapchat, why not, you know, because I have two teenagers at home, and what are they doing? They're snapping all the time, you know, they're too lazy to write a text message to a friend. What are they doing? They're just sending a snap. And then, okay, let's use that snaps in our classroom. Send a snap to your friend and make her guess, what are you doing now? Where are you? And what are you going to do? What are your plans, you know? And if you create classes like enjoyable activities, like games, mm-hmm. then they enjoy, and they don't think too much about what is the purpose of learning. They just participate, and that's the most important. Because if you are 10, 12, 13, you don't know the real purpose of studying. You know that you have to study because mommy says that, your teachers said that it's very important. But when you are 20, 30, then you know what was the purpose of that studying. And you are grateful because you had opportunity. But if you didn't study when you were 13, you will come to see me or any other of my colleagues to attend private classes and to learn something that you should learn much more easily when you were 7, 10, 15. So we need to create their objectives, and we have in our national curriculum outcomes. All national curriculums has outcomes, but we need really to use that outcomes like outcomes, the purpose of our classes, not just to write the outcome of today's class is to practice present perfect continuous. For the God's sake, why do I need that present perfect continuous? You know, you can't teach students like, okay, today we are going to learn present perfect continuous. And teenager thinks, why do I need that dance? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. No, you need to have different approach.
Yeah, I can relate to that. And you know, I think it's very important what you just said to make the learning process relatable. So if you're using technology and playing games with the apps that they use on a daily basis, it makes them more interested and more engaged, and they don't understand that they're actually learning or using the language, but they see it as a more, you know, fun thing that they would do anyway. So they're more motivated to participate. But in your, let's say, efforts to make everything more relatable, comfortable, interesting, do you also use CLIL as a method of teaching in your classes? And how do you integrate it with this curriculum that you just stated with the specific outcomes?
CLIL is my favorite, you know. you know, when I give my lectures and deliver my presentations, I always say that the English teachers have the biggest responsibility of all teachers, because our course books are full of information about history, geography, biology. We are connected to all subjects, you know, and if you use knowledge that they have from history class, geography class, and somehow you packed that into English class, it's much more interesting, you know. Actually, you simulate your students to develop critical thinking. Mm-hmm. If they learned in history classes about Henry VIII and his six wives, for example, and the Tudor family, why don't you use that in English class? Why don't make some cooperation with other colleagues? And if you don't have idea what to do, it's, you can always use the ideas from course books. All course books have great ideas, you know. Actually, it's very easy. You just need to scratch the surface and to find some interesting ideas. Once we found idea about composting in the course book, and that motivated us to do composting food from school canteen and to use that soil for spring. And we made a little garden in the school, you know, we put on flowers and...
Oh, that's nice.
Or recycling, you know, that's why I say that there is a great responsibility on us. We are really responsible for their education, but not only about English classes, you know. We need to help them to develop lifelong learning skills, and only English teachers can do that. Because if you need some books for history, for medicine, you will always find books in English. And English teachers are open-minded. Most of us are open-minded. And you can implement English in all other classes, with maths, with native language, with history, geography. We are the most important.
And also, you know, when we were preparing this podcast, you mentioned that one of your great interests is also cross-disciplinary classes. So I would like you to tell us a little bit about this and how it can be implemented, if it can be implemented easily in an ELT class. And what do you do? How do you deal with that? Shortly.
As I told, you have a lot of ideas in course books. And I find grammar teaching pretty boring. And sometimes I'm bored when I teach grammar. Mm-hmm. And for example, I invited a geography colleague when she was revising with students the North American continent. We used their knowledge from the North American continent to, I use that to teach definite article. Because we have all toponyms in the North American continent, I prepared some game. They needed to match toponyms on the map. And then let's make a conclusion. And the conclusion was that we have the Mississippi, the Colorado. So we use article the in front of the names of rivers and seas and oceans. You know, you just need to connect. And it's much more interesting to students when two or three subjects are teaching together. Two or three teachers connect together and teaching together. And school readings, they don't like school readings. But once with a Serbian teacher, Daniel Defoe, Robinson Crusoe, we made an interesting introduction And then they were really motivated to read that school reading, whole book, you know.
Mm-hmm. Great, wonderful.
Okay, so, you know, overall, your view about ELT in Serbian classes, is there anything that you would improve, anything that you would change? Do you think there's room for improvement? What's kind of like an overview?
Well, I would like to motivate more teachers, you know. I often deliver workshops in Serbia in different conferences, webinars, seminars, and I would like to involve more teachers, but not only English teachers. I would like to motivate them to use technology, to be open, you know. I have Instagram page, LinkedIn page. You can follow me to see what are my ideas. But I would like to have more classes, English classes, in our national curriculum. And I would like to show other colleagues how easy it is. You know, they are afraid of changes. And I would like to motivate more of them to use technology, you know. And I would like to put education in Serbia into better place, you know. It's not so popular. It's much easier to be singer or dancer or something like that. We have that new people who shows up in realities, and they're very popular in Serbia. And that's why I always show up on TV whenever they invite me to some talk shows, whenever they call me, can we visit your school? I always say yes, because I want to show my students how important education is, and that you can be successful. You can't be rich, but you can be successful. And even if you are a teacher, even if you are not a footballer, singer, reality player.
But you see, you had every right to feel like a VIP person, because if you're being invited by TV channels, that means that you are important. So, spot on.
Maybe they just like that I can talk for a long time.
All right. Are you ready for the VIP roast question?
The VIP roast. Extra special for you.
Extra special.
Okay, so the question is, what is the funniest question you have been asked during a lesson, and how did you respond to it?
Oh, well. The funniest question. Well, I can't maybe remember the funniest question, but the funniest situation was I was pretty young when I started teaching, and I was maybe 22, and during the class one student called me mommy, you know, and I was 22. I was shocked, you know. She's 14. I'm not ready to be your mommy. But now I got used to it. I am a mommy. And there was it was pretty funny situation. I was class teacher, you know, every 4 years you get a new class. And it was their prom night. And I was 28, maybe 29, and I still was single. And during that prom night, they ordered one song for me. That's a Serbian song, but it's about the auntie who has never got married. And that was always the question. When are you going to get married? When are you going to get married? Never. But at the end, I did it.
Oh, nice.
They like asking personal questions, you know. Actually, they like seeing that you're a human being, that you had bad marks when you were a student, that you had difficulties when you were a student, and that all of that is part of life. Yeah. There are barriers to solve, but you mustn't give up.
Exactly. No matter if you are a teacher, married, single, man, woman, that's always, you know, the message that needs to get across, that life goes on and you always need to be prepared for everything and simply move on.
Keep going forward.
Exactly.
Yeah, motivation actually is the most important. And I think that that's the our most important to be when you are a teacher, to motivate your students, not just to teach them languages, to motivate them to go on. You need to be psychologist, priest, auntie, mommy.
And I'm sure that you can be very successful motivating your students with this great personality that you have, this radiant personality. And of course, very passionate about what you do. So thank you for sharing some of this motivation with us today here at Teacher's Coffee. And we wish you all the best, Zdravka. All the best.
Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you. Goodbye, everyone.
Goodbye. Bye-bye.